Good morning, everybody. Ronan O'Halloran here. We're just going to give it another minute or so for everybody to get logged on, everybody to get their cups of coffee organized. And we'll start maybe in the next minute or so, if that's okay. Now we'll just give it one more minute, everybody, and we'll get started. So good morning, everybody. Ronan O'Halloran is my name. I'm part of the wealth management team here in Irish Life. First off, I'd like to thank everybody for joining us this morning. We're going to be talking about a couple of different things here. There's a huge progress of pension simplification coming to the country. I think we're right in the middle of it all, and things are going to get more simplified as time goes on. So we're going to address two major parts of this. One is going to be around PRSAs and the major changes that we've seen over the last 12 months in PRSAs, how they affect our clients, how they affect individuals. The second part of the talk is going to be around auto-enrolment, the changing pension legislation and landscape around that. My colleague Laura Duffy is going to speak around the PRSA and changes there. That part of the talk should take about 20 minutes. Then my colleague Noreen Stokes, is also a wealth management consultant here in Irish Life, is going to discuss auto-enrolment, what the timeframes are looking for like that, what the implications are, what we know so far. Again, it's going to be about 20 minutes for Noreen's talk. We're going to talk, but we'll have a session of Q&A then towards the end. So if you have any questions, you can put them into the chat there in the presentation here today. If you're on mobile, you can tap your screen. It should bring up your chat icon. So overall, I think we'll be about an hour, that sort of region. If there are questions that we can't address towards the end, you'll be able to discuss those in detail with your consultant on a one-to-one basis. So I'm going to pass over to my colleague Laura. Laura is going to give us the PRSA update. Thanks very much.
Thanks, Ronan. Good morning, everyone. So today I'm going to cover the changes that come into effect on the 1st of January 2023 to employer-sponsored PRSAs, what those new tax benefits are of these employer-sponsored PRSAs, some basic but vital requirements that are needed in order to set them up, a comparison between master trust company pensions versus PRSA, and some trip hazards that you may come across, and also what opportunities have been brought about by the change, and some case studies just to bring all that to life. So on the 1st of January 2023, as a result of the Finance Act, the Revenue Pensions Manual was updated, and it now states that there's no limit on employer contributions to an employee's PRSA. So what that means is that your employer or your company can pay whatever they want into a PRSA on your behalf. It's important to note, though, that the standard fund threshold for an individual of 2 million still applies. So there's no two ways about it. This has been a game changer for pension planning. It's the most radical change in the pension industry since the introduction of ARFs in 1999. And what it really means is that PRSAs now are the best solution for most company owners and individuals. They're a really simple product. There's no need for trusts or trustees. They offer great flexibility and also some very attractive benefits, which I'm going to bring you through today. So since the changes came about earlier this year, we have been receiving a lot of inquiries from individuals and accountants about whether various scenarios are possible. So we've put together this checklist, and we really feel that you need to be able to tick all of these in order for the payments to be tolerated by revenue. So the first one is pretty self-explanatory. The employee must be resident in the state and have an Irish PPS number. The next three are linked, so there must be a genuine employer-employee relationship. A Schedule E salary must be paid to the employee and they need to be registered as an employee on Ross. And revenue expect that tax release will be claimed in a routine fashion for bona fide commercial purposes. So what that basically means is there can't be a scenario where it's a made up job where you're employing your spouse or your son or daughter or your brother and you're paying into a pension for them when there's not an actual genuine employment going on there. So that has never been tolerated by revenue in the past and it won't be tolerated in these scenarios either. And then the last point is that we feel the company accountant should be comfortable with whatever is being claimed against corporation tax. And the reason we have this here is that really the company accountant is the only entity who has a very good idea of the overall picture of what's going on in the company, and they should be comfortable that these payments are appropriate also. Okay, so there is an incredible array of tax benefits available on PRSAs. Some of them were always there and some of them have been enhanced by these changes. So corporation tax relief applies to unlimited employer contributions to a PRSA. There's no benefit in kind on any of it. An employer single premium payment into a PRSA, the corporation tax relief for that is allowable in the year that it's paid. And this is very different to a company pension where an employer pays a single premium into a company pension. The tax relief, corporation tax relief for that may have to be spread forward over a maximum of 5 years, depending on the size of that payment. There's tax-free growth within the fund, and this is just as significant as the tax relief as the fund grows because it's not paying any tax in the accumulation stage. There's a tax-free lump sum available at retirement or a drawdown stage, and the amount of that will depend on the size of your fund, but it's up to 200,000 tax-free and then a further 300,000 taxed at 20%. And the very significant benefit for PRSAs is that if you die and you have a PRSA, the full value is paid to your estate on death, so no limit, no cap. Now, obviously there can be capital acquisition tax depending on who inherits it then, but there's no capital acquisition tax between spouses or civil partners. Okay, so I think it's important that we run through a comparison between company pension, master trusts, PRBs versus PRSAs, because as I said previously, that PRSAs now are probably the most suitable product for most business owners and individuals. There still will be scenarios where the company pension may be the correct structure for you, or a master trust. So we really feel it's important that you get advice from your financial advisor here, but I'm going to just bring you through some of the comparisons just to highlight them. So the first one is the lump sum that is based that you're able to take when you retire. In a PRSA, the maximum lump sum that's available to you is 25% of the fund, whereas in a company pension, you can take a lump sum based on salary and service up to 1.5 times your final salary or 25%. So if an individual comes to me and they say, you know, I'm actually just going to fund for a lump sum based on salary and service, or their salary is very high and their service is very long, this may be a scenario where the company pension is more beneficial for them. So that needs to be checked. The other important thing to think about is early access. So in a company pension, if you want to access your pension before the age of 60, so between 50 and 60, it's actually quite simple. You just have to have left that specific employment that the pension relates to. Now, 20% directors must dispose of their shares and sever all ties also. However, in a PRSA, if you want to access your pension before the age of 60, you need to be fully stop working, so economically inactive. So that's a big difference between the two pensions. So again, if an individual comes to me and they say, you know what, I think I need to going to need to access my pension before age 60, maybe I'm going to leave this employment and set up my own business, well then serious consideration is going to have to be given to the company pension rather than the PRSA at that point. We've mentioned already that there's no cap on employer contributions into a PRSA, whereas in a company pension, there would have to be a calculation done and based on your salary and service, there would be a maximum amount allowed to be paid into the company pension. This one is very significant as well, that there's no requirement to spread employer single premium relief over 5 years in a PRSA. So if you pay a single premium into a PRSA, you get corporation tax relief in the year it's paid, whereas in a company pension, it may have to be spread forward over a number of years. Death benefit, there's a difference between the two as well. So if you die and you have a PRSA, the full value is paid to your estate. Whereas in a company pension, the maximum lump sum that goes to your estate is 4 times your salary, and then anything that's left over provides benefits for your dependents. In a PRSA, there's a hidden tax benefit where you can split them into multiple PRSAs, and I'm going to cover that on a slide later. That's not available in a company pension. And then in a PRSA, you can actually defer taking your benefits or keep funding to age 75, whereas in a company pension, the max age that you can stay in a company pension and fund is to age 70. So again, there's quite a lot to go through there, and that's why it's really important that you speak to your advisor and see what is your current circumstances and ascertain what's the best route for you to go down. Okay, so this is a very busy slide, as you can see. I'm definitely not going to go through it all, but we just wanted to highlight some of the trip hazards that you may come across. So the first one, pre-retirement. Can you have a PRSA and company pension at the same time? Yes, you can. However, if you have a PRSA and company pension run in parallel, you're still subject to the revenue maximum funding rules. So having both doesn't increase your scope for funding, and there is a risk that you could become overfunded. Can you have a PRSA and a company pension for the same employment if you've taken your benefits from the company pension? Yes, you can. So we're actually seeing quite a lot of this recently, and I have a case study that will cover this later. So if you take your benefits from your company pension, you could then keep funding into a PRSA, but again, the standard fund threshold of 2 million will still apply. If an employee has a company pension and a PRSA running in parallel, it's just important to note that the employee contributions cannot go into the PRSA. They will need to go into the company pension, or you'd have to set up a PRSA AVC. Revenue have confirmed on point four here that anyone who has an employer paying into a PRSA are deemed to be in pensionable employment, so they're not eligible for personal pension term assurance, and that's a form of life cover. You'd need to speak to your financial advisor about that if you have that in place. And then the last one about transfers, with the changes that have come in earlier this year, there is no change to transfer rules, but transfers can be complex. Some are allowed, some are not. So you definitely need to get financial advice on that. So the main thing to take away from this slide is you really need to speak to your financial advisor and see, do any of these have an impact on any changes you're about to make, or if you're about to start a pension, you just really need to look at all aspects of that. Okay, so if you have clients yourself, or if an employer, or you're an individual with a company pension or an employee, we just kind of wanted to look at who might benefit from these changes to PRSAs. And I do have the case studies that are coming later will bring all of these to life, but just think it's just important to list them out there. It might be easy for you to look back on them after the presentation. So someone whose pension is already drawn, as I said, they're still working in the business, or maybe they've set up a new company and they've already taken their company benefits from their previous pension, they can potentially now fund up in a PRSA up to the max of age 75, and just to bear in mind that the standard fund threshold of 2 million will still apply. An individual who's over age 70, up until this year, we actually wouldn't have many options to offer them because they're outside the maximum age for company pension funding. So they can now look to have a second go at their funding and fund into a PRSA up until age 75. And if they have their own business and there's cash reserves there, could fund quite significantly into a PRSA up to the standard fund threshold of 2 million. Then an individual maybe who their company pension is at the max. So as I said, if you have a company pension, there is revenue maximum funding rules. So based on your salary and service, it will actually be dictated what is the maximum amount you can have in that company pension. So now that if they wanted to fund into a PRSA instead, they wouldn't be subject to those revenue maximum funding rules. So they'd have to transfer the PRSA or the company pension into the PRSA, and then look at funding a PRSA up to the standard fund threshold max of 2 million. The fourth point there, because there's no revenue maximum limits, it just makes it really simple to target certain funds now, and possibly could be done a lot quicker. Let's say targeting a fund of 400,000, 800,000, that will be covered in a case study later to show why I specifically mentioned those amount of funds, or even up to the standard fund threshold. Spouse's pension funding, I've mentioned already as well. If it is genuine employment within the business, we tend to see a lot that maybe the spouse's pension won't be funded until the first spouse's pension is at their max. But there's a lot to be said for maybe them running in parallel. And I will cover that on a case study as well. And then just again, the important note that any single payments into a PRSA tax corporation tax relief is given in the year they're paid. No requirement to spread the relief forward over 5 years. So there'll have to be serious consideration given for employers in that scenario who wish to pay single payments into a pension. Okay, so I'm just going to bring some of the case studies because I appreciate I've gone through a lot of facts there in the previous slides. So I'm hoping that these case studies will help it bring to life for you, and it may make, you know, identify with some of the areas that we've discussed. So a company director that we've been working with, he's age 68 now, but he accessed his company pension at age 61 for personal reasons. There was 240,000 in the pension at the time, so he took a 60,000 euro lump sum from the pension and transferred the balance to an ARF. The company has now turned a corner and is very profitable, and his children are going to be taking over the business soon. So him and his wife, who work in the business, are looking at taking as much money out of the company as they can, getting it into their own names before they pass over the business. So he's now looking at setting up a PRSA to accept a lump sum of 560,000 for him, and his wife, who has also been working in the business for the past 15 years, actually has no pension provision, so they're going to transfer 800,000 into a pension for her. So in doing those amounts, he's going to maximize his 200,000 tax-free lump sum, because he'll take 25% of 560,000, which will give him 140,000. So on top of the 60 he already got, he'll have gotten 200,000 completely tax-free from his pensions, and then his wife will be able to take 25% of the 800,000, which is 200,000, which is the max you can take completely tax-free. And then the second case study is company director of a family company, but he actually is also working as a physiotherapist, which is his primary job, but he's a shareholder in the family business, taking a salary from that business. So it is bona fide employment. He is actually working there as well. So now the company has a lot of cash reserves, so they're looking at setting up a PRSA and paying 500,000 into that. So prior to these changes, based on the salary and service that he has in the business, the family business, that they wouldn't have been able to fund to that level. So now this has opened up that opportunity for them. And then the next one is just to have a look at spouse's pension funding. I said we'd have a look at this. So John has a company pension, and there's 800,000 in it, and the company wishes to make an additional single payment of 800,000 into a pension. And John had been considering paying that into his pension, but we just had a look at two scenarios to compare which will be better. So in option one, if John pays it into a PRSA for himself, he will then have a pension fund of 1.6 million. 25% of that, the lump sum, is 400,000. He get 200 of that tax-free, and the balance will be taxed at 20%, which would give him a net lump sum of 360,000. But if we structure it in a different way, if the additional 800,000 is paid into a PRSA for his spouse, then she will have a fund of 800,000 also, and will be entitled to take 25%, which will be 200,000. So that will be a saving of 40,000 in tax, because they'll both get 200,000 tax free. So that's why I said earlier, it's important maybe to, in that scenario, have a look at where spouses are working in a business, to have their pensions running in parallel rather than heavily funding one first. There can be tax benefits for that. Okay. And then the next case study was just to look at, I mentioned in the comparison between company pensions and PRSAs that there may still be scenarios where a company pension is better. And in this case study, that is the case. So a client has a salary of 150,000 in their business, and they've over 20 years service, and they plan to retire from this company, and they're now considering making a 200,000 contribution into a pension. In option one, if they put the 200,000 into a PRSA, they'll be able to take 25% of the fund as a retirement lump sum, which is 50,000, and then the balance will either be invested in an ARF or used to purchase an annuity. Whereas in option two, if they set up a company pension and put the 200,000 in there, based on their salary and service, they'll be able to take 1.5 times their salary as a tax-free lump sum, which is actually 225,000 based on those figures. And therefore, they'll be able to extract the full amount tax-free from the pension. So in that scenario, the company pension is better than the PRSA. So again, really important that you get financial advice and make sure that what you've set up is appropriate for you. And then the last thing I just wanted to talk about was the multiple PRSA option. Again, a very busy slide, I'm not going to read through it all, but basically there is a hidden tax benefit in PRSAs. So you can use PRSAs as a tax planning tool at point of drawdown at retirement by splitting your pension fund into multiple PRSAs. And there's two main benefits of that. You get to control your income drawdown in retirement, because for PRSAs, the ones that you decide not to access, you're not obliged to take any income from them. And then also they'll have a very good death benefit. So as I mentioned earlier, if you die and you have a PRSA that you haven't accessed, the full amount will be paid to your estate. So for this example, it's obviously a very large pension fund of over 2.1 million. The clients split it into 10 PRSAs. And if you look at scenario one, they've got their first PRSA with 200,000 in it, and they decide they are going to draw that pension down. So they take 25% of the fund as a lump sum, which is 50,000. And then with the remaining 150,000, it either stays in the PRSA as a best of PRSA or transfers to an ARF. And once you've that done, you are obliged to take income from that fund, and that income is taxable. So between 61 and 71, you're obliged to take 4%. So they would have to take 4% of the 150,000. But because this individual has spread it over multiple PRSAs, they're not obliged to take income from PRSA 2 to 10 yet, because they haven't drawn them down, and they can control when they do that. And as I said, if they happen to die at some point along the planning time, the PRSAs that haven't been accessed will be paid fully to the estate. So that is a hidden tax benefit of PRSAs. So thank you. That's all I'm going to cover today in the PRSAs. I know there is a lot to go through. I will be here at the end to answer any questions. And then I really recommend that you meet with your individual advisor then to go through any of those scenarios that you feel you need to talk about. And I'm going to hand you over to my colleague Noreen now.
Thanks, Laura. That was a very informative presentation. So I'd like to bring everyone today through auto-enrolment. And I suppose from the reading of the first slide, is it 2024, is it 2025? So currently, a revenue have made an announcement that it is going to be in September 2024. But obviously, that's not guaranteed. We would feel that there's a lot of structures that need to be put into place before auto-enrolment can really go live in September of 2024. But Irish Life as a company and us as a group, we're certainly working towards auto-enrolment coming in September of 2024. So I suppose why auto-enrolment and some of the backgrounds, why the government has looked at auto-enrolment. So in Ireland as a whole, we have a very much an ageing population. Over 65s are set to double in the next 30 years. And currently that's 15% of our population. So obviously there's a real concern. There's actually in Ireland 800,000 people who are employed who currently have no pension funding. So this is part of the reason that the Irish government are looking at setting up auto-enrolment. Currently 35% of the private sector have pension funding. So that's a huge amount of people without any pension funding at all. The Irish pension assets currently are at 120 billion. That's approximately 35% of the overall economies globally. And that would be very, very low compared. Affordability, I suppose the state pension, we'd have a question about that. Is it affordable at retirement just to live on the state pension? And I'll go through that in the next slide. And I suppose the complexity of the Irish pension system as it stands currently. So in relation to the old age pension, so we'll just go through auto-enrolment and why auto-enrolment. So the government are currently embarking on a progressive and positive reform programme where they'll see auto-enrolment savings policies introduced to Ireland. So the aim for this is to have auto-enrolment introduced to encourage people, as I said earlier, who currently have no pension funding to actually start saving for a pension. And it also makes it easier for employers to offer an employee a workplace pension scheme. So currently the state pension, it currently stands at €265.30 per week. That's a maximum of €13,765 per annum. So what we would say here is like, you know, can people really afford to live on €13,500 a year at retirement? And we would feel very much no, and would have a real concern that we would have some people facing into poverty at retirement. So, you know, this is currently where it stands. To qualify for the state contributory pension, you must be age 66, or if you're 65 currently, you will have a bridging pension. pension. But, you know, currently the age of retirement, of getting the old age contributory pension, is 66. So if you were to retire today and you were looking to get your pension, you would actually have a 3 month waiting before you would actually receive any income. So it takes 3 months for the old age pension to come into play. And then I suppose many people will use mywelfare.ie, etc., to get some information in relation to the old age pension. So auto-enrolment, what is it? So basically, the state are looking to set up an SSIA style pension up and help fund for 33% of an employee contribution. The marginal tax relief will not apply. This has some potential to make auto-enrolment attractive for those who aren't paying income tax and the 20% tax rate, but it's potentially less attractive for people who are on the 40% tax relief. So the government have said that there is no plan to change the marginal tax rate relief currently on contributions for PRSA or personal pension plan, that the two-tier system will still apply. Employers will be able to offset their contribution against corporation tax just in the same way that they can for occupational pension schemes. So the plan currently, and again, I will say this with a caveat, that this is a very fluid plan. We still feel that there's a lot of things to be ironed out with the government before auto-enrolment will come in place. But the information that we have as it stands is that the employees will look from year 1 to 3 to contribute 1.5%. The employer then will look at contributing 1.5%, and then the state will look at topping it up by 0.5%. And then as the years go on, obviously the amounts will increase, so that in year 10, it should look like something like an employee contribution of 6%, an employer contribution of 6%, and then 2% contribution for the state. So that's what we feel it will look like when it comes to auto-enrolment. So who can enrol and who's it for? So it's for people aged between 23 and 60 earning over 20,000 per annum. Now, if you have an employee under the age of 23 that wishes to contribute, they absolutely can, but they won't be automatically auto-enrolled. Employees already in a pension scheme where the employer is contributing, they will not need to enrol in the auto-enrolment system. Presumably, there will be a requirement that any occupation pension scheme or PRSA will need an employer and employee contribution at least equivalent to the auto-enrolment scheme. So I suppose, just to clarify there, what we're saying is anyone who's already in a pension scheme that, say, for example, is a PRSA and it's employer deducted, but yet there's no employer contribution, potentially they will have to pay in to that pension scheme from September 2024 onwards. So there is a cap, obviously, then on the contributions, which is 80,000. So what that really means is anyone who's earning over 80,000 won't have to contribute to the scheme, but potentially they may be able to. But at the moment, there is no nobody allowed contribute over the salary of 80,000. So what I suppose, just to kind of break it down, so every €3 that an employee puts in, the employer will also put €3 in, and then the state will top it up by €1. And then to clarify, there will be no other tax relief available on it. So what that really means is for every €3 an employee puts into the pension scheme, technically €7 will go into his pension scheme. So it's very attractive for the people on the marginal rate of tax. So I suppose then the terms and conditions, as I said there in the earlier slide, initially it's looking like there will be no flexibility at any other salary percentage. So in other words, that you will be stuck to the 1.5% of salary contribution. There has been some indications that there might be, this might be added later on, that, you know, flexibility might come into play, but currently at the moment there is no flexibility to that. It will be optional for employees to contribute on earnings over 80,000. So again, there should be flexibility on that. On month 7 and 8, an employee can opt out. So what that really means is if they decide they don't want to contribute to the pension plan anymore, they certainly can opt out on month 7 and 8. Now, if an employee opts out, obviously an employer can also opt out and doesn't have to pay any further premiums. Now, there's also a caveat there that the government will automatically auto-enroll you every 2 years. So if you have opted out in month 7 and 8, you will be reintroduced, re-enrolled technically in on the second year anniversary. So, and then what it's going to look like, they're kind of trying to mirror what we would call an occupational pension style scheme, where there'll be an employer contribution and an employee contribution, and then the government contribution will be in the four, or the government contribution, which if you were in an occupational pension scheme, would be a tax rebate. So there will be no tax rebate, there will just be the government contribution to it. So I suppose in everything there's some disadvantages, and these are just disadvantages that we would feel at the moment, and very much some of these could be ironed out before it comes to September 2024. So there's no access to the benefit until retirement age. And the minimum contributions are also the maximum contributions, and there will be no single premiums allowed. But again, this may change in the future. So in a lot of circumstances, especially with occupational pension schemes, people would like to put their bonuses into their pension scheme, or they may do a top up in relation to get tax relief for the October 31st deadline. But the auto-enrolment will be very structured. You will only be able to put in the agreed amounts of 1.5 and 1.5 as you go up along the years. So currently there's no target funding or max funding possible outside the fixed contribution rates. Again, we would look at that as a disadvantage for a lot of customers who are very much funding for retirement, who have a specific amount that they would like in their pension pot in their head. It wouldn't really be suitable for them. And I suppose we don't know what the lump sum or the retirement options will be in the longer term. And I guess that is quite a disadvantage as well. So advantages, certainly there's lots of advantages, and I suppose the charges that are intended will be very competitive. So, you know, that's really good news. There's intention to minimise the hassle for the employers by making the process as seamless as possible. The government have a hope to set up what's going to be known as a central processing authority, where potentially that they will manage the administration of the pension fund. Again, that isn't set up. So at this moment in time, we would have the caveat that we're not sure if all this will be ready by September 2024, but we would hope it would be. It could end the pressure, I guess, to set up a personal pension. You know, from an industry perspective, we would be quite concerned to think that there's 800,000 employed people in Ireland that currently have no pension. So, you know, a lot of people would be maybe nervous about coming to meet a financial advisor, or it's just the file on your desk that, you know, I need to pick it up and go look at it. But, you know, it's something that people aren't very, very confident doing it. So, you know, we think that it's going to end that pressure. Employers then can write off contributions against corporation tax in the way they do with private pensions. So that's very advantageous for employers as well. So then we look at, I suppose, the implications of auto enrollment for our clients. So, you know, what we said earlier, like, this is really going to raise the awareness that everyone in the country needs a pension. You know, I would probably say to everyone today, like, if you imagine you come to retirement and all you have to live on is 13,500 a year from the Irish government. Now, I appreciate that potentially will rise as the year goes on, but it still won't be enough to help people to live at retirement. And I suppose, you know, we really would be concerned in relation to that some people will be facing poverty in retirement. So I think it's a really positive move for the industry, and it's going to really raise real awareness about the need for having a pension policy. And many people will end up having a supplementary pension that they wouldn't otherwise have. And, like, that's a really positive move as well. I suppose overall we wouldn't expect it to have a significant impact on business owners or sole traders, because a lot of these people are already funding a pension and are very much on a route for planning for their retirement. And I suppose that in turn, it really is designed to intend to cater for the hospitality sector, the retail sector, the drink sector, where there is a high turnover of staff, and largely where there's no pension existing at the moment. Arguably, the incentives are good for some standard taxpayers, but they're not so good for the high taxpayers. And it's relatively the marginal rate income tax relief, which is currently available in other style pensions. So, you know, overall, we think auto-enrolment is very, very positive. I guess we do feel that there is a lot of things to be ironed out with the government and revenue before it will come in place. But what I would say to everyone here today is, is that, like, you know, we do know it is coming and it will come. When it will come is still a little bit up in the air. But if I was someone in payroll or, you know, working in accounts, I would be planning and I would be putting into the budget for auto-enrolment. Whether it comes in 24 or 25 is yet to be seen, but it's certainly something that I would be planning towards. And then I suppose we'll go on to the next slide there where, you know, why Irish Life? So Irish Life, we're uniquely positioned to help our clients meet their pension objectives. You know, we've been managing investments for over 80 years. We've been managing defined contribution plans since 1983. We've been providing services to over 3,000 sponsored defined contribution plans in Ireland. And we manage 8 of the 10 biggest Irish companies with 9 of the 10 biggest US companies in Ireland. So, you know, we actually represent 230,000 individual employees in Ireland. So I think if you're looking for pension advice and if you're looking at, you know, feeling that auto-enrolment is going to be an issue for your company, we would say to you that really you should come and talk to us now about auto-enrolment. We're certainly poised and in a great position and we have plenty of people who have plenty of knowledge and expertise in the pension industry that can help get your company set up for auto-enrolment and be ready for what will come eventually.
Hey, that's super. Look, Noreen, first off, I'd like to say like thanks a million for that. Laura, thanks a million for that. I suppose there's a huge amount of information here, first off. Some really, really significant changes around the PRSA legislation and some huge changes coming with auto-enrolment when we do see it coming up. We're going to just go through a few questions that are coming in. Let's address some of the questions coming in. So there was one question, I suppose, for yourself, Noreen. So saying, like, will the employer have to pay the 1.5% contribution into a PRSA or a company pension if a staff member doesn't opt for auto enrollment?
As far as we know, as I would say, I would give the caveat that this is a very fluid situation, but it's from our reading of the information that's come out, if an employee doesn't contribute, the employer doesn't have to contribute. But the issue being that the employee will have to contribute. Everybody will have to be involved in auto-enrolment. Now, as I said in my earlier slide, they will have the option to opt out in month 7 and 8. Okay, so and then the employer will not have to contribute after month 7 and 8 if the employee decides not to contribute, but they certainly will all have to contribute from the outset. And as I said earlier, if they opt out on month 7 and 8, in year 2, the government is going to come back and do an automatic auto-enrolment again for everybody, and then they will have to start again and, you know, they'll be re-enrolled and they will be an employee and employer contribution expected.
Super. Thanks for that, Noreen. And one for you there, Laura, just a question around the PRSAs. Someone's just asking here, if an individual has an existing company pension arrangement and they've already hit the revenue maximum limits for that company pension arrangement, could they then continue to fund through a PRSA maybe above those limits?
Sorry, I was muted there. That was kind of covered in one of my slides where I said if someone has a company pension and they're at their revenue maximum, they could now look at funding through a PRSA. They would have to transfer their company pension into the PRSA because if you have a company pension and a PRSA running in parallel, you are still subject to those revenue maximum funding limits. So if it is allowable that their company pension can go into the PRSA, then they could look at funding further into the PRSA up to the standard fund threshold of 2 million.
Very good. Thanks, Laura. And another one just on the PRSA as well as we're talking to them. Like somebody asking here, I think you covered it off, but just saying, look, what's the earliest an individual could claim retirement benefits from a PRSA? Is it the same as a company?
No, it's different. So the earliest without restriction is age 60 in a PRSA. If you want to access it between age 50 and 60, you have to be completely economically inactive. So it is kind of, it does seem a little bit of a ridiculous rule compared to the company pension. So who knows, maybe they will change that in the future. Every kind of finance bill, they sometimes change a few of these things, because in a company pension, you can access them between age 50 and 60, as long as you've just fully stopped working in that employment that the company pension relates to. Whereas in the PRSA, the rules as they currently stand is you have to be completely stopped working everywhere. So they are different.
Okay, perfect. Thanks, Laura. And one for yourself there, Noreen, around the auto-enrolment, just saying, look, when does the state auto-enrolment come into effect? Like, when could we expect these changes to happen?
Yeah, well, it's currently set that it will come into place in September 2024. But as I said earlier, we haven't been made aware that it's not coming in September 2024. But we do feel that there's some structures that need to be put in place prior to coming in. And unless everyone works very, very hard until now and September 2024, we'd be unsure if it definitely will. So as I said, I will be planning from a financial point of view to be prepared for auto enrolment in September 2024. And if it comes in, it comes in. And, you know, if the government gets their structure together, well, that would be great. But we're currently unsure. And we can only advise people with the information that we have today. And that is that it is to come into place in September 2024.
Super. Thanks, Noreen. And just another, just another one then on the auto enrolment. What would happen in the case of women who, say, for example, would take maternity leave? Would they be entitled to top up their pension to account for gaps in service, or will their employers continue to contribute whilst they're on maternity leave?
Yeah, I guess that's a very difficult one. And I suppose women in the workplace, you know, we've a lot of work done in that in Irish life. You know, we are a lot more likely to take time off to, you know, obviously have children or be carers at home, etc. And if you look at the current rules and regulations in relation to auto enrollment, it doesn't look like that you'll be able to do a lump sum. It looks like it's going to be very structured, and that you won't be able to top up. And I suppose if you're off work and you're not getting a salary, potentially you won't be able to contribute to it. But again, I would imagine that, you know, we don't know would be the correct answer. If you look at it, it doesn't look likely, but potentially we would hope that a lot of these issues would be ironed out between now and September, and we would hope that nobody will be disadvantaged. So.
Super. That's great. Thanks, Noreen. And one for you there, Laura, just somebody asking, could your employer pay a single premium to a PRSA while the member is already in a company pension scheme? And could the employee get tax relief for both?
OK, so two parts of that. Yes, an individual can have a company pension and a PRSA running in parallel. So the regular contributions, let's say, could be going into the company pension, and then the employer, I think that's what they're asking, then pay a single premium into the PRSA, because I guess the employer is thinking they'll get corporation tax relief in the year that they make that payment into the PRSA as opposed to the company pension. So they can be running in parallel. That is possible. However, as I said previously, you are still subject to revenue maximum funding rules then. So just to make sure that the individual wouldn't be overfunded. Then you asked, would the employee get tax relief? So I guess it depends who's making the single premium, who will get tax relief. So that's not clear, sorry, on that one. But if the employer pays it into the PRSA, they will get corporation tax relief in the year that they pay it.
That's super. Thanks, Laura. Just asking as well, saying here, I suppose there's talks about maybe making PRSAs whole of life. You mentioned in your the multiple PRSAs being drawn down and deferring that drawdown all the way up to age 75, that there could be changes being mooted at the moment to say, well, look, a PRSA becomes a whole of life contract. Any thoughts on that?
Yeah, the amendment is proposed for PRSAs to become a whole of life product, and we would welcome that. I think it's probably part of the overall simplification of pensions that the government is trying to introduce. And that would then mean that an individual can be in a PRSA for their accumulation stage and bring it right through to drawing benefits and then for the rest of their life until they die. So we would welcome a change like that if that definitely comes into play.
OK, super. Another question for you here, Noreen. So it's just asking, if the employee opts out in month 7 and 8 and gets auto enrolled 2 years later, does the employee have to pay again until month 7 or 8, or can they opt out again immediately after the 2 year auto enrollment?
I suppose I don't have the answer to that question. And again, I would only be giving my own personal opinion on it. All we know at this moment in time is that you cannot out on month 7 and 8, and you will be re-enrolled after the 2 years. So I don't know, Ronan, and that's the truth of it. I would imagine it will be the same rules would apply, but again, we have no clarification on that at this point.
Yeah, perfect. And there's another question there coming in for yourself, Noreen, around employers paying it to PRSA. It's just saying, look, if the employee is paying 5% of salary into a PRSA, will the employer then have to put in 1.5%? And again, that's probably something that we don't have real clarification on. We're saying presumably it will be the case, but no, nothing really firm on that just yet.
No, exactly, Roland. I suppose the view is that the government wants every employer to contribute to a pension plan for an employee, whether it be a PRSA or auto-enrolment. If someone has already something in place, they won't need to be auto-enrolled. But again, we will be very much giving our own opinion on that, that we would imagine an employee would have to give the 1.5% to that. But again, we certainly don't have the exact facts of it at this point in time.
Yeah, I suppose it is something that's going to evolve over time. Yeah. The closer we get to that date, the more concrete all these facts are going to be.
Yeah.
Laura, just one last question there on the PRSAs. Just saying, have you seen sort of, I suppose, anecdotally, because you're dealing with your own client, but have you seen maybe a shift towards PRSAs for employees who aren't company directors or business owners?
Yes, definitely. They're a much simpler product. More flexible. So when we bring people through the advice process, more likely than not now, our advice will be the PRSA over the company pension for each individual that we meet. So there's definitely a shift towards PRSAs over company pensions at the moment.
Yeah, and I suppose it does reinforce that need for advice then as well. Like you were mentioning that if you have an employee that maybe has 20 years service with an employer, that maybe that salary service lump sum could be more preferential. Yeah. It really is a case by case basis.
Definitely. So we bring everyone through the same advice process. And then based on what your circumstances are, we are going to recommend either a company pension or a PRSA for you. We will show you both. You can go with either. And I'm just trying to think myself over the last few weeks, it is a very busy pension period for us, and out of the last 10 pension advice that I would have gave, 9 of them are PRSAs and 1 is company pension, and the 1 that is company pension is purely because, well, 2 reasons actually. The individual told me that they may need to access their pension early because they're going to set up their own business, so that would make me think the company pension is better. And then the second reason is that their salary and service is high and long. So when I looked at all the facts and figures behind that, I felt that the company pension was better because the reason he wants to access it early is to set up his own business. So, and it looks like that they'll get a higher lump sum out of the company pension versus the PRSA. But all the other clients I've met over the last 2 months, apart from that one person, the PRSA was the recommendation.
Super. Thanks, Laura. And I suppose there's another question here which probably reinforces the need for somebody to speak to their advisor to get sort of individual advice around specific circumstances. But they're just saying, look, at retirement from a company at age 65, for example, could the company pension and AVCs be transferred into a PRSA at retirement?
Yes. As I said, the pension transfer rules are complex. So some of them are possible and some of them are not. But in that scenario, it may be possible. And I'm just wondering, why are they thinking of doing that? Was there anything else on the question?
No, that was all on the question for that one.
So if they've already done their funding and it's in the company pension, you know, you can access from the company pension and you have access to 25% lump sum, you know, or lump sum based on salary and service. So there may be no need to do the transfer unless they're thinking of transferring it in so that they can fund further. Or maybe, I don't know, I don't need to know more information about that.
Yeah, so probably is one to maybe like on an individual basis speak to your advisor and get some good guidance.
Yeah, or if that person who asked the question wants to email in more information on that or to speak to me about it, that's no problem.
Super, thanks for that, Laura. So I suppose there's got another couple of questions coming in. Just can we get a copy of the slides and a copy of the presentation? Absolutely, we'll make a copy of the deck available for everybody after the talk, and we'll also send you out a link that you can get access to the webinar as well. So conscious that there was quite a bit of information, a lot of things to consider for ourselves, for our clients, for our employees. I don't see any more questions coming in there at the moment. So first off, I'd like to thank everybody for your time today. Thanks to Laura. Thanks to Noreen. I found it really, really informative. I hope everybody has left maybe learning a little bit more and maybe catching up on a few bits of points that we probably need to address for our own finances maybe too. So look, thanks a million, everybody. Brilliant that you all attended this morning. And if you do have questions, you can contact your advisor. We'll also make, if you don't have an advisor, we have an email address there for the wealth management team in Irish Life. So we welcome any queries you might have. Thanks again, everybody, and enjoy the rest of your day. Take care.
Thanks, Ron.